About contracts, and we've done it a million times. For the very last time, what's required to form a contract? Go ahead, I heard, I think it was Cynthia said it.
Agreement.
Oh, Delia said it. Agreement, so there needs to be an offer and acceptance, some type of meeting of the minds. What else do we need?
Consideration.
Consideration. What's consideration? You learned that last class. Good, money, something of value being exchanged. So I go out and I buy a TV on Black Friday. I get the TV, they get my cash. And legality, the contract needs to be around legal subject matter. You know, the law's not gonna help enforce contracts having to do with drugs. And the last piece here, capacity, you need to be able to understand the exchange. Things like being too young, under 18 as a minor under the law. Things like being, you know, too drunk or on the influence of drugs or having a mental disability could impair your ability to have the meeting of the minds. Okay, so we learned about the requirements of a contract over the past couple weeks. We talked about legality capacity in our last class. That lecture, that video is now posted for you. We're going to move on now to the final topics in contracts, which are writing and then third parties to contracts. Okay, so do contracts have to be in writing? Not all of them, so they don't have to be in writing. We're gonna learn today some exceptions to that. Should they be? Yes, so we've talked before about that. They should be, and let me give you an example. I told you I have a twin sister. Spinning images, we used to switch places when we were students. The teachers never caught us. There was like 400 students in the class. So anyway, my sister and I, we're twins, we spend too much time together. So, you know, I told you before, she runs a business, a commercial business. One of those locations is out of the ground, the basement level of my house. Again, we had about a year to get that level commercially zoned, and now she owns and operates a business out of it, so I have to lease her that space for that business. Do you think I care about having that in writing? Not really. It's my twin sister. Like, I'm not worried about her, you know, paying me her rent payments and whatever else. But even if I'm just trying to be nice, it's my twin, nothing could ever go wrong. First of all, sometimes things go wrong when it comes down to money. And even if they don't, there's two reasons why it's helpful for us to have a lease. First of all, you forget. Time goes by and you forget what you agreed to. So her and I agreed we were going to have a really low base rent payment, and then she'd pay a little more for each client she got. That way she was not losing money by operating that business, but as the business grew and she became more profitable, then we'd be paid a fairer rent. Seem fair? What we couldn't remember was what we would do if she had a client that was full-time versus part-time, if there was a prorated rate, and just couldn't remember what we agreed to. So having something in writing, we're able to just look back to it, and then it's totally fine, and we don't have to try to like renegotiate what the situation is. The other reason it's important is there's people sometimes who won't care about those contracts who have nothing to do with me and my sister. So for instance, if I go to sell my home, they'll be very interested in the fact that there's a commercial space that gives extra value to the home and the fact that it's been able to lease regularly for a period of time. If there's no lease agreement, it's hard to prove that. So usually banks will want to see not only a lease, but also sometimes the actual payments coming through. So it's important just to have the paperwork just to be safe so everything's in writing. Also, if something happened, like my sister or I were to pass away, you know, it's good to have some documentation in case you run into an issue with whoever takes on their estate. We'll learn about estates more in a moment. Okay, so it's a good thing to put it in writing just to make sure everyone understands. It doesn't always have to be in writing. We're going to talk about when it does have to be today. The instances, there's 7 of them where it has to be in writing. Usually it's because if it's not, there can be a lot of disputes. They're around kind of heavy things like land, like marriage, and there can be some issues that arise. So the law says, you know what, there's been so many complications around this, let's just make sure that everything's really clear and in writing. So today we'll talk about what contracts have to be in writing under what's called the statute of frauds. We'll also talk about what is actually required to be in that piece of writing. We'll look at this idea of peril evidence. And then the last part of our discussion today has to do with third parties. Okay, so my sister and I have that contract agreement. Her employees benefit from it. They get a job, right? Are they involved in our contract? No. So we're going to look at, do they have a right then? If our contract, if I break my contract to my sister, do they have a right to sue me too? So we'll look at third parties who are affected by the contract, whether or not they have some legal rights to go after you if you break your contract. And we'll also talk about giving away your benefits of the contract to somebody else and your obligations, any obligations you might have. So I'm going to jump forward here to talk about what contracts have to be in writing. Okay, so this idea of the statute of frauds, you want to write that down as soon as I close the door. Under the statute of frauds, many agreements are unenforceable, okay, unless they are in writing. So even though we talked about agreements don't have to be in writing, there's seven of them that do. Okay, that being said, you know there's always exceptions. The law gets fussy, right? If a contract has been fully executed, it does not matter if it was in writing, even if it's supposed to be. What does it mean for a contract to be fully executed? Good, I heard a couple people say it. Javon, Sebastian, credit to both of you. It's completed. So imagine this. I'm going to sell a vacation to the Bahamas. Anyone interested?
Sure.
Everyone, right? It's like it's winter. We all want to get out of here. Everyone's interested. So $1,000, you can go to the Bahamas. You can stay as long as you want, all inclusive. Seem like a really good rate? Great. Okay, Javon seems the most excited, so I'm going to let Javon go to the Bahamas. So Javon's going to the Bahamas. He pays me $1,000. He gets on the plane. He's in the Bahamas. And then he's like, you know what? Never mind. Like, I want my $1,000 back, and I kind of want to go home. I miss school. I miss coming in at 9:30 in the morning in the cold and, you know, sitting in through class. And so I'm going to come home. Okay. He's already executed the contract. Why else would he be in the Bahamas? Why else would he have given me that money if we hadn't already had some type of an agreement? So to come back now and say, well, it should have been in writing, does that seem fair to me?
No.
No, so he can't get his $1,000 back. So when it's already been fully executed, when you've already exchanged the value, why else would you be exchanging it? It's not fair for someone to go, oh, should have been in writing, not enforceable. Remember, contract law is very fair. So this has to do with contracts that have not been completed yet. Okay, so there's seven instances. We're going to learn about these in a lot of detail. You'll see these on the board here. I'm going to give you a really easy way to remember each of them while we watch this annoying video. Like the annoying video we saw earlier this semester, you're going to be annoyed with me because the song will probably be stuck in your head, but I'm hoping it'll help you remember these seven instances. So I will put the way for you to remember these on the board as the video is going on. The term for it is called my legs. Is that easy to remember? Good, because that's how I learned it in law school, and it's been a while since I was in law school, and I still remember. Because it's my legs. Easy, easy. My legs, and as they're singing through, we'll spell out what the my legs stands for, and then we'll talk about each in a little more detail.
Still okay, but it's a fact for six kinds of acts. The statute of frauds requires a written contract. Please, oh please, won't you marry me? I will give you riches and jewels that shine. I say I do, and marry you as soon as you sign on the dotted line. Oh, I had to say that any day. An oral contract is still okay, but it's a fact for six kinds of pacts. The statute of frauds requires a written contract. If one day a party say the debt of another she guarantees, if no writing there's no denying, the contract lacks enforceability. Yeah, but don't forget you may enforce it yet. Leading object of the debt was to benefit the one who said it, and an oral contract the law will permit. When an estate debt cannot wait, the executor pledges payment personally. That pledge is tossed from coast to coast when the promise is made simply orally. Oh, I'm glad to say that any day. An oral contract is still okay, but it's a fact for six kinds of pacts. The statute of frauds requires a written contract. If it appears that within a year the contract performance intentions won't be undone. But don't forget you may enforce it yet. Even lifetime employment, enforceability applies orally. How long-term sounding it appears to be. If it's land, we understand that's the subject of an interest transferring. If money spent even just for rent of more than a year, you need some scribbling. But don't forget you may enforce it yet. If a buyer's made partial payment and entered the land or built something grand, or if promissory estoppel rules take command. Finally, under the UCC, a sale of goods worth 500 or more. The UCC treats writings differently, and a full written contract may not be a...
Whoever makes those songs is genius, right? So great. So I'm going to jump forward here to talk about each of these in more detail. I encourage you to write this down in your notes. This could be really helpful for your index cards, for the exams, to remember, like, hey, if I see something like this on the exam, one of these six areas, this could be something that needs to be in writing. I need to think a little bit about this one. So again, my legs. We're going to talk about each. Contracts that have to do with consideration of marriage. Okay, this doesn't mean if someone doesn't show up to the altar, you know, we can go to the judge and say you have to marry them. That doesn't seem fair, right? Yeah, so this is the idea of if someone's giving you something of value to marry them. We'll talk more about that. Something that cannot be performed in a year. Land. A land, a house, property, those are big purchases and they're unique. You know, if someone's trying to buy my home, it's that specific location, it's hard to get another cookie cutter resemblance of that home, and it's never going to be on the exact same land. So because that's such a big deal, we want to make sure it's in writing. Executors of estates, we'll talk about that. Goods, $500 or more, that's where the UCC applies. And then surety. Surety stands for the debt of another. We'll talk more about that as well. So the first here, this one's easy, it's interest in land. If you see land or property being involved, there should be a contract in writing. In fact, if you go to buy a home, especially here in Maryland, when you make an offer to buy the home, it is long, pages and pages, it's over like 30 pages they have to sign and go through just to make the offer. And then when you actually sign, and they call it a closing on the home, it takes a few hours to close on the home. You're doing a lot of signing, everything's in writing, down to showing you a survey of the plot of the land. Okay, so they really want to make sure that there's good documentation for that property. Now, there's some exceptions to this. Yes, it needs to be in writing, but again, if you fully performed. So anyone want to buy a house? I got a house for sale for anyone who wants. 930, Devon's already going to the Bahamas. Who wants a home? Good. Sanya gets a new home. It's a $1 million home. Are you excited?
Yes.
Good. And you have $1 million kicking around. So if Sanya gives me $1 million, I give her her dream house. Fully executed, she's living in the home. It's been about 6 months. Then she's like, you know what, I think there's ghosts in the house. I feel like there's ghosts here, and she doesn't like ghosts, and so she goes, you know what, never mind. Professor Weiser, take this money, give me back my money, I don't want to live here anymore. Does that seem fair to me?
No,
because I could have sold it to G, and she would have even paid me a little more. What the heck, right? So once it's been fully performed, she can't go back and say, oh, well, we didn't put it in writing, so you got to give me the money back. Hey, that's not fair. It's not an excuse to make sure the agreement is taken care of and to be able to breach it, but it should be in writing from the beginning. On top of that part performance, if it's not in writing, if you partially perform, so let's say she doesn't give me the full million, she gives me like a couple hundred thousand, and she's supposed to pay me the rest over a 10-year period. Okay, so it's still in process, but she moves into the home and she builds a deck. And she replaces all the windows, and she decides that it's really important that they add heated floors to the home, and she redoes all the landscaping, and has she made some improvements? Yeah, so she's living in the home like it's her own home. She's paid some of the money. That's enough, even if it's not fully executed, that she can't go back and say, well, there's nothing written down, give me my money back, and I don't want this house anymore. Okay. The last piece of this, as with everything, if there's no contract, we have a couple options, right? The law will still enforce a promise using promissory estoppel. So if you make a promise, it's likely they rely on it, they do rely on it, and it causes some harm, the law might still enforce it anyway. So while it should be in writing, you'll see when you go through the house buying process, it will all be in writing to be safe. You do do have some kind of areas to help you to still make sure it's fair. So that was this one, land. Going back to our next one here under my legs, the why. Contracts that cannot be performed within a year. If it's not capable of being performed within a year, it should be in writing. Okay, here's why. Chelsea Handler, I have any fans? Chelsea Handler? I gotta change this picture. Sebastian doesn't even know her. No one, Javon likes her. There we go. I got one out of 30. I gotta change this picture. So Chelsea Handler claims that this comedy club hired her on January 15th to perform 2 years later, January 15th, 2017. They work out all the terms of the agreement. Do you think anyone remembers 2 years later what all those agreement terms are? No. That's why they just want to make sure it's in writing. It's just too long. People forget. So if it's over a year, it needs to be in writing. Now, this seems crazy, but it does happen. Okay, so I do a guest lecture for Leadership Montgomery. Business ethics is one of the areas I focus in, and so I go there and teach some of the high-level leaders in this area. They do various trainings, and one of them is an ethics training. They usually schedule me for that about a year and a half in advance. Does anyone have any idea a year and a half what they're going to do? No, so like they schedule it, and then I'm going, oh my God, okay, yeah, I'm free on that date because I haven't planned anything else for a year and a half from now. And as it gets closer, if I run into an issue, that's going to be a problem. So again, that's something that you put in writing so you can say, yes, we had this scheduled date. If I were to breach it, they could go after me then and say, well, you're not getting your payment, although I volunteer to do that. So down here, the payment of a debt of another, this is called surety. This is only helpful in the my legs thing if you remember what surety means, right? So surety is paying the debt of another. Now here's why this is so important. Let's see, I gave someone a house, Sinya got a house, Javon got a trip to the Bahamas. Who wants tuition paid today? There should be a lot more hands for that, Maddie, you ready? Okay. I would love that. I had to pay to get myself through school, it's hard, right? So I'm paying for your tuition, Maddie, sound good? Great. So Maddie takes out a bunch of student loans, right, from federal government, and they're like, yeah, Maddie, you don't have bad credit. You're young, you don't have bad credit, but you don't have any credit. So you know what, Professor Weiser is gonna co-sign for you. Does that sound good? I'm going to co-sign for Maddie so she can get all that money out. So she takes out a bunch of loans, and if Maddie doesn't pay, I co-sign, so I'm responsible, right?
Yes.
Anyone have parents who maybe did that in here you're thinking of now? When your parents co-sign on your financial aid, they're saying, if Maddie doesn't pay, I will. They're guaranteeing that debt. Now, Maddie, you don't want to pay, right? Because I told you I was paying it. Yeah, she's like, I want my free tuition, Professor Weiser. What the heck? So she doesn't pay for it. And they come after me. Do you think I want to pay? No, I didn't get that degree, right? What the heck? I had to pay for my own degree. Why do I got to pay for Maddie's now? So they want this in writing because I'm going to cause a dispute, right? Not only is it debt, if Maddie's going to not want to pay that debt, I don't want to pay it. I didn't even get anything from it. So if you make an agreement to pay the debt of another person, it has to be in writing. Because generally, you're not going to be thrilled to do that, right? Please be careful about that with your parents. Sometimes they don't realize like exactly what they're doing when they co-sign, so they just sign the dotted line. If you owe $50,000 for school and your parents co-signed, you both have that $50,000 debt because they, through suretyship, have guaranteed that money. If you're not paying it, they could have an extra $50,000 debt. You both show as having that extra $50,000 debt. So it's a big deal. And say thank you if they did do that for you because that was really nice of them. So debt of another has to be in writing. Same kind of situation now if it's an executor of an estate. We've mentioned this briefly before. Does anyone remember what an executor of an estate is? What's an estate? Not like real estate. Part of it, go ahead. Yeah, it's what you have. Assets are things that you have that have value. So things that you have when you pass away. So if I die tomorrow, you know, I have, we'll say, $1,000 in my bank account, I have my home, I have my car, where does all that stuff go? That's what we call an estate. You can choose someone to be your executor. You know, I can choose my brother or my sister to be my executor. Okay, or you could choose a lawyer to do it or an accountant to do it. You can choose someone to make sure, I want to make sure that my car goes to my daughter and my $1,000 in my bank account goes to my sister. Otherwise, if you do not specify that in a will, which is what most people would do, it goes into what's called probate, okay, which means state by state, they'll choose where your stuff's going to go. Usually it goes to your next of kin, state by state that varies, but it's usually going to be your spouse, if they exist, if you have one, and then beyond your spouse, any children you might have, if they exist. If they don't exist, usually what's next is like your parents. And so the state, it's a slow process, it'll take a while, but your stuff will go kind of in order to who your next of kin are. I encourage you to just write down who you might want things to go to, just to be safe. If you have something written down, it's faster and it makes it a little clearer. Okay, that's the idea behind a will and why so many people do that. So again, an estate, this is the person, the executor, the one who's kind of just dealing with all your stuff. Now, it's not just things you have of value. I told you guys I have lots of debt from going to law school. I had to pay for school. I have a lot of degrees and I have the debt to show for it, okay? So that debt that's there does not go away when I die. So if I die tomorrow, you know, all of that huge debt, my husband's going to have to pay for it. Exciting, right? Mm-hmm. We share, right? We're married. We're in love. So that's what he got. That's what he married into. So the executor of the state, you know, when they're trying to figure out how do we pay off this stuff, they're going to do things like we can pay off some of the loans with the house, the value of the house, or with the car. So those are the kinds of things that are really, really important. If an executor decides, I'm going to pay off something like there's $2,000 left on the car. I can't really get the $1,000 in Hannah's bank account yet because I can't find the password and the bank's giving me a hard time proving that Hannah's dead. It's going to take a while. So I'm just going to go ahead and pay that. And then once the car's paid off and we do get access to Hannah's bank account, I'll take the money back. That gets kind of messy. Executors do that stuff a lot just to streamline things. So because they do that, we put it into writing. It's like paying the debt of another. We want to make sure it's in writing so that if we run into issues, we can make sure they get paid. If you think about that, if you have a checking account right now, it's easy to log in with your password, you know that exists. It's really difficult when you die, you have to prove to the bank. You know, my husband goes in and has to prove I'm dead with a death certificate, which can take a while to get, and then the bank has to make sure it's okay, and then they'll finally give you access to the account. It's a long process. Whereas he can go, you know what, this car, there's a payment coming due, there's going to be extra fees building up, so I'm going to just quick pay this to make sure it gets taken care of. I'll get the money later. Things like that happen all the time while they're trying to deal with the debts and the things we have. Go ahead, there's a question from him.
Yeah, I was wondering, is it true that they put like an ad in case you do pass away, in case you have any like kids or anything around?
Great question. So Henry just asked a question. If you do die, you know, all the stuff that you have, and you're like really mean and grumpy and you don't have any family and you don't have any friends and like you just like die alone, yeah, they could, probate might say, like, hey, anyone who's related to this person, they're supposed to try to get a hold of, you know, next of kin going in order who would be able to get that stuff. Otherwise, it'll revert back to the state. So they'll try, and they might try by taking an ad out. My long-lost, you know, cousin that has millions of dollars, it could be good, right? Mm-hmm. So another thing here in terms of what has to be in writing, my legs, if something is made in consideration of marriage, that M. So again, my husband and I were supposed to get married. We're standing at the altar, and I'm like, oh, I'm not going to do this, and I go running, right? He can't go to the judge and say, force Professor Weiser to marry me. That's not good, right? We don't want to force people to be in these like long-term things they don't want to be in. They'll just end up getting divorced. Not a good idea. So that's not the point here. Things you do in consideration of marriage. What does consideration mean again? Good, is something of value being exchanged? Now, could it also be something you give up?
Yes.
So what's an example of something like I could give up doing?
Drinking.
Okay? So I'm over 21. Do I have a legal right to drink? Yes. But let's say my husband, he's very against drinking. He says, I don't want to spend my life with someone who drinks. I had a brother who died from drinking and driving. I'm very against it. I'll marry you, but you need to not drink for 2 years before we do. And then we'll get married. Okay, things like that, they need to be in writing. Because now I give up drinking for 2 years. I'm like, hey, time to marry me. And he's like, yeah, never mind. I'm not into it anymore. I'm going to be upset, right? So we need to make sure if it's something of value you're doing to get married, then usually we want that to be in writing. Just because it can get in a little messy. Okay? That seems weird, but if you think about it, you know, we got married, we had a child. That could be really important to someone that, you know, me, being the mother of that child, that I was not drinking or doing drugs, that could be very important to them. And so that does happen. There's things sometimes you say, yes, I'll marry you. It's a big commitment. There's something of value that I need in order to do that. Now, this one's easy. The sale of goods. Anything greater than $500 has to be in writing. What law applies when it's the sale of goods?
UCC.
The Uniform Commercial Code, the UCC. So we'll look at some areas where we see some distinctions for that. Also in Maryland, lease of goods, if they're over $1,000, need to be in writing as well. So if you go and get something like a car and your lease is over $1,000, that also will need to be in writing. Okay. Your hand was up. Go ahead, Eduardo.
Yeah. So in the previous exercise and the previous thing about marriage, so if there was something, an agreement or something that, so then what did the judge will do?
Oh, what will he do? What will he do if my husband won't marry? He's going to force him to marry me. That's a jerk thing to do, right? I'm just kidding. He's going to give me some type of financial, some kind of monetary benefit if my husband bails. Okay, if that's the remedy I'm looking for. And he's not going to force him to marry me. Because then we'll just get divorced, which is expensive and time-consuming in the courts. So we saw the six areas where it has to be in writing. A couple other things that we need to chat about in terms of writing. Here's what the writing has to contain. It has to be some type of memo that has to be signed by the defendant. Now, can it be like on a napkin?
Yeah.
As long as it's signed by the defendant, right? Usually both parties sign. Why does it only matter that the defendant signed it? He's the one fighting it, right? So he's the one going on to agree to this, so we need to show that there is proof he did agree to it. That's why it matters his signature is there. We just put both signatures there because we don't know eventually who's going to be arguing that there's an issue with the agreement. So usually both parties' signatures will be there. The other thing you need to do is state with reasonable certainty three things. So again, this is something that you could see on an exam because we need to make sure if we say something's in writing, we have what's required of that writing. One, that there's a memo of some sort that's signed by the parties. And two, the name of the parties, the subject matter, and the essential terms and promises. So who are the people in the contract? What is the contract about? And what exactly are we agreeing to? That seems to make sense, right? Common sense. So for a lease agreement, we'll put the names of like the landlord and the tenant, the person who's renting the space. We'll put the address of the property, describe the property, and then over here, the terms and conditions. So things like whether or not you can sublet, whether or not you can have pets on the property, what your security deposit looks like, what your rent payment looks like. All the details of the agreement should be listed. Now, under electronic contracts, there's a couple laws that say these are valid. Okay, just because they're not like on a napkin or written down on paper, and just because you don't physically sign with a pen, it still counts as a valid signature. So e-signatures are valid in all 50 states. Okay, almost all states have adopted what's called the Uniform Electronic Transactions Act, the UETA, and that's what declares electronics, contracts, and signatures are just as enforceable as the ones we have printed on paper. Now, this is interesting because years ago, I'll tell you, UMass, I teach for UMass. This is going to be my seventh semester teaching for UMass online. I love UMass because it's my undergrad. 7 years. When I first started, every time I teach for them, they'd send me a physical contract. I'd have to physically print it, sign it, and then send it back in the mail. It's not the end of the world, but it's annoying, right? Mm-hmm. Finally, this year. They're allowing. They send an email. They send my contract. I just have to sign like on the screen of my phone, and it sends it back to them. It's all automatic, and everyone sees the approvals, and they all sign on their phone. Just as okay, because we have the UETA. It says that's just as valid as the written one that you printed out, signed, and mailed back. Electronic signatures in global and national commerce, e-sign, also declares that contracts cannot be denied enforcement simply because they're in electronic form or signed electronically. So here we have some new protections that came into place as we started using things like email. Bless you, Jake. Email. We started signing things on the computers. You know, for us, we all grew up with these things, but our parents and their generations before did not. And so it's important to show, like, hey, it's just as valid. Now, the other thing where we see a difference, like we've seen throughout the semester, is under the UCC with the statute of frauds. There's some exceptions here. So the UCC, again, applies to the sale of goods, right? Writing for the sale of goods worth $500 or more, we saw that right here, there's going to be easier requirements to meet. So The first part of this, the basic rule, a contract for sale of goods or 500 or more is not enforceable unless there's some sort of writing signed by the defendant indicating you reached an agreement. So what do we need, going back to what we learned earlier? If it's not the sale of goods and it needs to be in writing, it needs to be writing signed by the defendant. What else is supposed to be there? Name of each party. There was two other things. The details, all the terms in the agreement, and one other thing, the subject matter. Under the UCC, all we need is some type of indication that you reached an agreement. So it's, again, very flexible. We saw this earlier this semester, where under the common law, contract, the offer and acceptance needs to be very definite. If I say something like, I'm going to sell you a box of hats, I need to say there will be 25 hats in that box. Whereas under the UCC, it's okay to just say, I'm going to sell you 25 hats, you know, and then we'll assume, hey, the market rate for those is $30. Here we see another exception. If it's for the sale of goods, the writing still needs to be signed by the defendant. It still needs to be some type of writing, but we don't need to have the name, the subject matter, all the terms. We just need some type of indication there's an agreement. That's going to be enough. Eduardo?
Oh, but that would be not the open. You said previously that when a contract is completed, in this case, the selling of a good in an exchange, you don't need like a contract, like a written contract.
Yeah, so keep in mind for all of these exceptions, again, once the contract's complete, it's been executed, it doesn't matter if it was in writing and all these things were there or not. Absolutely. Okay, so here, this is, you know, I am a company and I'm ordering 10 computers. They'll usually mail the computers and then send an invoice. I haven't paid yet, it's still in progress. Okay, this isn't, I already bought them and it's 6 months later and now I'm arguing, hey, there was no contract. Okay. There's another exception here. We're gonna look at a case to see this example more clearly because it's a big deal. It's called the merchant's exception. So you wanna write that down, that term, that idea of a merchant's exception. What this says is that if you make an oral contract, it's a business, another business. They don't put it in writing, they say it orally. And then one sends a confirmation to the other of what the agreement was. And the other person, the other business, fails to object within 10 days. They get the letter in the mail about the agreement. They don't say anything. It's considered to be an acceptance. Anyone ever like not open their mail for a couple weeks because you're away on vacation? So this is scary for a business. You are responsible to object. If someone's sending you a confirmation letter saying we have this contract agreement, within 10 days you need to respond if you do not want to accept it. So that's a big deal. If you're going to go to Europe for a month and you own a business, make sure that you delegate this responsibility to someone so if anything comes in, you can object. I'm going to show you an example of this. It seems crazy that this would happen, but I'm going to give you a scenario where you will see that it does. Before we jump into that, I want to give you one more exception when we're talking about the sale of goods. Generally needs to be in writing. We talked about there's some flexibility about the writing. We talked about even a confirmation's enough. The last piece is it can be enforceable if it's specially manufactured. So the holidays are coming up. Anyone ever make like a photo calendar or photo mug for your parents? Photo puzzle? No one? Oh, it's so cute. So you're like, hey, you know, I can't think of what to do, so I'll spend like $20. I'll give you a big mug with my face on it. What else would you want to see, right? So who wants to do that for their parents? Anyone? Yeah, right? That's a good idea. Thank you. Yeah, there's a bunch of companies that do it. Shutterfly, Apple, whatever. So Henry's like, I'm going to do that. I'll put my nice little face on a mug for my parents. And what's better than that? The gift of me. So he gives that to his parents. Now imagine, you know, he gets the mug and he's like, you know what? Never mind. I don't really want this. I don't really want to do this. Forget it. Does anyone else want that mug besides Henry's parents?
Not
her. Sorry, Henry. Probably not very much. Yeah, maybe his long lost love, but probably not very much. If it's been specially manufactured, why else would they have put his face on the mug if he didn't want that, right? And then they put him in a bad place, right? Because now the business, like, what are they supposed to do with a mug of Henry? Okay, so if it's specially manufactured, even if it's not in writing, Okay, he buys this $500 like crystal, you know, sculpture of him for them to put in their home. It's not really fair to say, oh, it wasn't in writing, so, you know, I'm not going to pay for that. Now, the company might have a policy where they allow you to do that kind of thing as a customer service thing. But generally, from a contract level, if you specially manufacture a good, does it matter if it's in writing or not? If you admit that there's a contract in court proceedings, it's just as good as it being in writing, so keep that in mind, too. And then the last piece of this, if the goods have been delivered or they've been paid for, now we've executed the contract, it's complete. You can't go back and say, oh, it wasn't in writing. Okay. So I want to give you an example of this merchant exception. With a big business, I'm going to erase this. You all got a good picture of that? I'm going to erase this because this case is a little complicated with the players involved. You're not going to recognize a couple of the businesses. You will recognize General Motors. Who's General Motors? Big car company. We've actually mentioned them a couple times before. This is actually a case about them and some of their suppliers. And you will see in the end of this case, the supplier will get $34 million. $34 million. And the issue all comes down to that merchant exception we talked about. Merchant exception again?
If you don't sign the contract,
you don't object within 10 days. You're agreeing to the contract. So let's look at an example of how this would play out. We don't know who Eaton and Lear are, right? But we did know General Motors. So let's get them on the board here. Just so we keep track of all these players. We have General Motors. Okay, they hire Lear. So, hey, we need Lear. And what they want Lear to do is to build leather seats for all the General Motors, like trucks and cars. Is that a big contract?
Yeah.
So usually what will happen is like a big car company like General Motors, they're going to hire Lear to do the seats. They're going to hire Katie's business to do the steering wheels, Kiana's to do the airbags. We got to get the parts from somewhere, right? And these are all the suppliers. Now, would the UCC be involved here? Or the common law? Which contract law are we going to look to? UCC or common law? 50-50 chance of getting it right. So we have a business with another business. Mm-hmm. Talking about the sale of cars. Which law applies?
UCC.
The UCC. We have the sale of goods. Are cars usually more than $500?
Yeah.
So does this need to be in writing probably too?
Yeah.
All right. So we learned something good. So here's what happens. GM hires Lear to build the leather seats. To build a leather seat, what do you think you probably need?
Leather.
Good, Sinya. So Lear then hires Seaton to provide all the leather for those seats. Is that a big contract for Seaton?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So they're the ones bringing this lawsuit to try to get some money because there was an issue that arose. So here's what happens. Lots of big contracts going on. Lear and Seaton agree that Seaton would provide Lear with the cut-to-pattern leather so they can make the seats for the General Motors cars. Lear's going to then assemble them and put them in, and they get a discount, right? Because Lear is getting all the leather from Seaton. It's a pretty large order, right? Seaton gives them a better price. So instead of just buying leather, you know, from the clothing store, they're going to buy it in bulk from Seaton. So both parties perform the contract for about a year, pretty long time, at which time they agree to modify that discount. In fall of 1999, Lear asks Seaton to send a writing summarizing the agreement. So they agree to give these bigger discounts. They do it verbally. And they say, hey, put this into writing. Lear actually asks Seaton to put it into writing. So Seaton does. They wait. It's around November. They send a one-page memo summarizing the agreement to Lear and stating, Lear is to award Seaton the entire truck and SUV program cut to pattern business for the life of the program. So what does that give Seaton?
Lifetime contract.
A lifetime contract. Is that good for Seaton's business?
Yes.
That's a huge contract. We're talking a multi-million dollar thing. And for Lear, that means they can't get any leather from anybody else, but they're probably getting a pretty good discount from Seaton for it. So everybody wins, right? Lear just ignores that letter. Okay, the letter ends with a request that they kindly return an acknowledged signature, and they refuse. The Lear just doesn't do it. Why does Lear not just sign the memo they asked them to write? Go ahead, Simon.
They didn't like the contract?
Yeah, they're like, why would I sign this contract and only be able to get leather from Seton? I already am getting the discounts, right? This is the cow giving the milk first, right? I'm already getting these discounts. So if I just don't sign this, then if I need to, I can hire a different supplier, but I'll still get my good discounts acting like Seton's my exclusive supplier. Gives them more options, right? This is very common in the business field. Here we see the parties work together for 2 more years like that. I thought everyone's happy still. But Seton then gets kind of anxious that Lear might go take their business elsewhere. And so in January, they send a letter again asking them to affirm this exclusive commitment. If I'm going to give you these big discounts, you can't go get leather from somebody else. And then Lear responds that there's never been such an agreement like that. And they're like, screw that, I'm going to go get my leather from Deborah. Well, that stinks for Seton, right? They just lost a huge account. So Seton sues, and here we are. They claim, Lear, that no contract has ever been signed. Seton says there absolutely is a contract.
Because of
what?
Of the previous memo that
because of the memo. So we agree this was supposed to be in writing?
Yes.
Is there a writer?
Yes.
So what does the issue come down to when we talk about contracts? Is there a capacity issue?
No.
Legality?
No.
Is it consideration? Is there something of value being exchanged?
Yes.
Yeah, so agreement. Was there an offer being made?
Yes.
Was it accepted?
No, but it was receiving. I mean,
yeah,
we
didn't
know
any parts of the...
Good, Dahlia. So what's the issue here? Did they accept?
Yeah. They're already doing the business for 2 years.
Okay, so there's two pieces of it. First of all, did they sign it, right? Normally you'd sign it to accept, but did they sign it?
No.
But there was another way they accepted. How can you also show you accept instead of a signature?
Exchange.
The performance. So for 2 years, things keep going, right? They perform. So you can show you accept by actually doing the contract. For 2 years, they keep doing this, which is a long time. How else do we know they accepted? Good. So under the merchant exception rule, when that letter was sent saying, here's our agreement, Lear was responsible to object within 10 days. Did they object?
No.
No. And then they kept performing for 2 years. So who wins? Seton won this case. We'll see here. They actually won. Where is it? No, I wanted to show you how much they won. It's on here somewhere. It was $34 million, I think. Is it on here? The first one? There it is. $34 million. Okay, so this was a big contract. It was a big deal. And this is where we see that merchant exception come into play. Okay, this issue of things being in writing. And all of this is normal. It's normal for a big business to go to other businesses to get supplies, for them to have discounts, for being the exclusive supplier, to work together for a while, to verbally agree to some things, and then to see someone not following through. When we're talking about millions of dollars, it's a big deal, which is why we have this writing requirement. Now, the other thing that's really important when we talk about things being in writing is stuff that was said and not included in that contract. It wasn't written down. So that idea is what's called parallel evidence. Okay, anything apart from the written contract itself is parallel evidence. So you know, normally when you're doing a contract, there'll be some type of term, some clause in it that says this is an integrated contract. Everything that we've agreed to is in this piece of writing. That way, if we go back later and say, well, no, we have this other agreement, they'll say, no, we didn't. You know, because if it was the case, it should have been in the writing as well. I told you I used to do family law at Feldman Tucker. It was like a top family law firm in D.C. They were number 2 when I was there. I don't know where they are now. So they handled some really big clients who made millions of dollars. If they were able to afford to hire Feldman Tucker, they definitely had some money. Okay. We would make an agreement about who got what in a divorce, you know, who got the custody of the kids, who gets the car, who gets this, who gets that. It was really important. Everything was in that piece of writing. So if there's a piece of art hanging on the wall, there's my art on the wall, you know, and Sinya and I are getting a divorce, and Sinya's like, I want the art. If I forget to put it in that piece of writing, that's parallel evidence. Later on, they're going to go, no, you know, Hannah kept it. Too bad, Sinya. So it's really important, if you're making a written contract, that you include everything that you're agreeing to, so that people can't add this extra stuff in there. Okay. Now, even if this happens, we have some exceptions, as always, if it's ambiguous. Now, if we just say in the agreement, like, anything hanging in the house, Sinya gets. You know, well, they might say, well, that's not really fair. There's, like, a fan hanging in there and some other stuff. And you need to be specific. The piece of art that looks like a phone goes to Sinya, okay? Aren't you lucky? I gave you a house earlier, okay? So if it's ambiguous, it's unclear, they might allow some outside evidence that wasn't in the written contract to make it clear. And then Sinya can testify, well, we had this conversation on the date of January 2002, and you said I could have the phone art, and who cares about the phone art, right? The last piece of this, the misrepresentation or duress, they will permit if there's been some type of duress, we talked about that before, okay, some type of fraud, misrepresentation of what's going on, then they will allow some outside evidence as well. But generally, if it's supposed to be in writing, everything needs to be in there. Go ahead, yeah.
So this is like a pre-agreement to the agreement?
It's not like a pre-agreement. What it is if we say it needs to be in writing, you know, for example, this divorce, everything that's going on in the divorce, everything needs to be written in the agreement. We can't go back later and say, oh, well, it wasn't in the agreement, but we did discuss this idea that Sinya gets this R. And even though we didn't write it down, it was in the agreement, you know, we agreed to it verbally, so it's okay. They're going to say, no, all the terms and conditions should have been in that written contract. You can't testify later about it. Okay, so anything that's not in the contract, I'm going to necessarily allow that evidence. Does that help? So we learned about what has to be in writing, what's in the writing. We're going to talk a bit now about third parties, and then we're going to do some review of all the contract stuff. We have an activity to review all this. We talk about third parties. This is someone who is not a party to the contract, but they do stand to benefit from it. And if it's intentional, if you intend for them to benefit, then they can sue if there's been a breach of contract. They have the same kind of rights as the two original parties do. If you just happened to benefit from it, you don't really have any rights. Want that to make sense from like a normal standpoint? I'm going to give you an example of that. Wynn College Park, University of Maryland. Anyone been there before? Beautiful campus, right? Anyone go there by metro? Jerron, how far was the walk from the metro? Pretty far, yeah. So it's a long walk to get from the College Park metro stop to the actual University of Maryland College Park campus. Does that seem like a good idea when there's so many students on that campus? No. But at the time, they're like, oh, if we put a metro stop on campus, there's going to be a bunch of crime and safety issues, right? They already have a bunch of crime and safety issues still. But they also have people having a hard time getting to campus. Okay, so when they were going to build that metro stop, if they build a metro stop somewhere, do you think that benefits the businesses around it?
Yes.
Why is that? Especially in this area, most people don't have cars, so as Henry said, it's more convenient.
Apartments, houses built around it.
There's going to be a lot of development around it because it's more accessible, so we'll see all of a sudden various businesses popping up, housing popping up, literally right on the metro too. Because now they've made another way for you, you know, even if it's going to take you an hour to get to DC, you have a way of getting there. So you'll pay to live on the metro or around the metro so that you can easily access everything else that's accessible from the metro. Now, when they build that metro stop, is ABC Business that gets a space near where it's located, is that going to be part of the contract? You build a metro stop here. So I'm like, hey, there's a metro stop here. I'm going to put an ABC Business, a pizza business, right next to it. Because you just told me there's going to be a lot of people riding the metro, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm putting a business here. Am I part of that original contract with the metro? And so all these issues we're having right now in Maryland with the purple line and it might not come to be and all that kind of stuff. The metro stop doesn't actually get there, but I bought ABC Pizza Stop thinking that it was going to be really, really profitable because there was going to be a metro stop there. Can I do anything about that?
No.
No, because I'm not involved in the contract. So that's the idea of a third party, right? There's a metro stop. Metro is supposed to build this beautiful stop. You know, I intend to benefit from that as a business nearby. University of Maryland, had the metro been closer, would really benefit from that. But you're not part of the contract. So unless it's intentional that it's a gift or some way to repay a debt to you, just because you're impacted by the contract doesn't mean that you have rights under the contract. That makes sense? Mm-hmm. So it happens. When we have a new metro stop, there is a lot of development around it, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's smart. Yeah. You know, if you even think there's going to be a metro stop coming to be in that area, it'd be smart as a business to go build an apartment building.
The price will go up.
The price will go up once the metro comes to be. If it doesn't come to be, It was a risk you took. You're in a bad spot. Okay? But you were not part of the original contract. Eduardo.
So what are the metro contract is part of it? Like, how the, what is, will be the example of a contract, like in the metro? Like, yeah, in the metro will be, metro has contract with...
So the metro can make a contract with, let's say you own a bunch of land, like over by, right near College Park, you own a ton of land and they want to build a metro stop there, so they pay you, Eduardo, millions of dollars to build a metro stop there. And you say, okay, right?
Yeah.
Good, you're a multimillionaire. It's a good day for this class. So he's a multimillionaire, he's going to let them build the metro stop, and then you change your mind. You're like, you know what? Catherine complained, and Maddie complained, and Allison complained about this metro stop. It's going to bring a lot of harm to the community, and I'm nervous about it now. I changed my mind, I'm not going to sell it to you. Did you break the contract and the agreement that we had?
Yes.
Yeah. And that stinks for ABC Pizza Shop that was really excited about the metro stop coming to be. You and I have an issue. The pizza shop can't do a lot about it.
Okay.
Unless I was trying to do this, buy the land and build a metro stop as some way to give a gift to the pizza shop, or if it was a way to fulfill some type of loan or obligation I had to them. Unless I intend that the pizza shop benefit from Eduardo selling me land to build a metro stop, then they don't really have any rights under the contract. So let me show you a scenario of that. Oh, good, it's a pizza shop again. I wonder why that was. So here we go. Suppose a Major League Baseball team. Anyone into baseball here? Ah, Major League Baseball team, soccer team, whatever team you want. They contract to purchase from a seller 20 acres of an abandoned industrial site. Okay, so is this land seem very valuable?
Yeah.
Not really, but they're going to purchase it, and they want to build a new baseball stadium. Now, wouldn't that be a good thing for the community and all the businesses around it? Awesome. So the owner of a pizza place is on the edge of that seller's land. Are they going to benefit?
Yeah.
Yeah, so look here. There's going to be 40,000 hungry fans at that stadium for 81 home games every season. Okay, pizza sales are going to go up. The seller was hoping to make this contract partially as a gift to the pizza place. So they've been going to this local pizza shop because they lived in this land nearby for years and years and years with their family. In this case, they intend that pizza shop will benefit. They want them to have this great business going on because they're going to bring in the baseball stadium. So they hope it will be a gift. After being a loyal customer for many years, what if the contract falls apart? Okay, suddenly the stadium decides, never mind, we don't want to buy that industrial site. Does the pizza place have any rights under this contract? Can they go after the stadium?
Yes. Pizza can sue.
Yes. Why can they sue?
Because they will benefit.
Because, not because they'll benefit, right? Even if you'll benefit, you don't necessarily have any rights. It's intended. And that's the big difference here. Okay? It was intended they would benefit. It was intended there would be some type of gift for the pizza place. It gave them as a third party some rights under the contract. So you want to look to what the intentions were. Just because you benefit from a contract doesn't mean you have rights if it's broken. If you were intended to benefit, either as a gift or because someone's trying to repay you, then you have some rights. So the last topic for today, we're going to talk about if you want to give away your rights or your duties under the contract. A contracting party may transfer their rights or benefits under the contract. That is called an assignment. I'm going to write that term down. If I'm getting benefits under a contract, I can then transfer those benefits to someone else. So, for example, I told you my sister rents that space from me. Let's say she's paying $1,000 a month, and I owe Riley $1,000 a month. I can have my sister make that payment straight to Riley. I'm transferring my rights under our contract to Riley for a year to pay off the debt I have to him. You can transfer your rights. That's called an assignment. Now, if it's an obligation that you're transferring, that's called a delegation. If you have a duty you're delegating, it's called a delegation. So let's look at assignment versus delegation. Under assignment, a contracting party, again, can transfer their rights under a contract, any benefits that you have. Now, most rights under a contract are assignable. You can give them to somebody else. If you're getting a benefit, it's okay for you to give it to somebody else. As always, there's a few exceptions. One is if it would substantially change your rights or duties under the contract. If by giving your benefits to somebody else, it'll change the contract significantly, it's not okay. Another is if it's forbidden by law or public policy for you to transfer those rights. And the last one is if the contract says you can't do that. You know, if the contract says no transferring these rights. You know, if I'm making a $1,000 rent payment, it only goes to you. You can't transfer it to someone else. I'm not going to pay that payment directly to Riley. You have to take your $1,000 rent check, cash it, and then you can pay Riley yourself. The other way it's prohibited is if you agree to perform personal services. Personal services are very attached to the person performing them. So here's an example of that. We're throwing a party next week, end of semester. We're going to have a big party, pizza party, the pizza place that got screwed in the last example. They get to provide the pizza. And we're going to invite any band or DJ or musician you guys want to invite. Who do you want to invite?
Jay-Z.
Jay-Z, that's an easy one. Good. Because the last class, they wanted to invite 21 Savage, and I have no idea who that rapper is. It made me feel really old, and I'm not that old yet, so let's use Jay-Z. Good. Me and Jay-Z, we're on a good first name basis. Jay-Z and me. All right, so we got Jay-Z. He's coming to our party. How much do we have to pay him? That's it? 15?
100,000.
Let's pay him 100,000. It's Jay-Z. Come on.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to pay Jay-Z some money. He's going to come to our party. Now, Jay-Z, the night before, he goes out. He gets into the situation. He's been drinking. He had a little too much fun. He's tired, and he doesn't really feel like coming to our 9:30 a.m. party next week. Fair enough, right? But he wants his $100,000 because him and Beyonce are about to have a new baby, and he's really excited, and he needs to make sure he can get the baby like a gold piece of jewelry or something, okay? So instead, he sends in his friend Javon. Javon's going to perform for us. Thanks, Javon. Are you guys as excited as Jay-Z?
No.
How about Beyonce? He's sending in his wife.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. If it's for personal services, it's very much attached to who's providing them. You're not going to be thrilled if Jay-Z doesn't show up that day. Okay, so he can't just give that, assign that benefit to somebody else and have them come in and take the money from it. Okay, because you wanted Jay-Z, not Beyonce. Maybe you want Beyonce. Not Beyonce, not Javon. You wanted Jay-Z to perform. Now, rights are assigned really easily. It can be orally, it can be in writing. You just need to give notice. If there's consideration, you can't revoke it later. But really, just letting them know, I'm assigning these rights. Okay, I need to tell my sister, like, hey, you need to pay Riley the payments directly. That's okay. Once the assignment's made, you notified them, you can enforce the contractual rights. So now Riley can go after my sister if she's not making those payments. He can go after me as well, but he also has a right to go after my sister because I delegate. Now, the assignor's warranty. Under the UCC, of course, we have an exception here. The obliger on a sales contract may generally assert any defenses against the assignee that arise from the contract and any other defenses that arose before notice. So even before notice was given, it's like you have all the same rights. If you were transferred benefits, you have all the same rights to bring lawsuits about the contract being broken. Now, the other piece here is a delegation of duties. You may delegate your responsibilities under the contract, okay, any obligations you may have, unless it would violate public policy. Again, we don't want to enforce promises that violate the law or public policy. If the contract says you can't delegate it, you cannot give your responsibility to somebody else, you must do it. Or if there's a substantial interest in some type of personal performance. You know, I really want to make sure that my sister is the one providing those checks because my sister. Now, I want to give you an example of this in a term that will probably help you because some of you are renting now or will rent an apartment or home in your life. Okay, generally, you cannot delegate your responsibilities to another person. So who was going to the Bahamas? Javon, you were going to the Bahamas. Javon lives in an apartment with Milton, and the two of them each pay $500 a month rent. Okay, who bought the house? Sinya. Okay, they're living in her $1 million home, only $500 each rent. Okay, Javon's going to the Bahamas, so he goes ahead and rents out his space to Rolando. Rolando, you're paying $500 a month. Milton's paying $500 a month to Sinya. Now, Rolando's like, screw that, you know, I'm going to go to Mexico if he's in the Bahamas. Does Milton have to pay the $500 still? Yeah, and Sinya can go after him for that. She can also go after him for the full $1,000. On top of that, she can go after Javon for the $500 or the full $1,000 because he was originally on the contract. Even if he delegated that responsibility to Rolando, he originally was the person on the contract, he has to pay. She can go after any of them. So this gives the landlord, Sinya, a lot of ability to make sure she gets paid her $1,000. She can't go get $1,000 from all three of them. Now she got more rent than she was supposed to. She got triple rent, right? But if she's having trouble getting the $1,000 from Milton because he's going, I only have to pay $500, and she's having trouble getting the $500 from Rolando because he's like, yeah, you know, I don't know what I got into here, she can still go after Javon for the other $500. What she would have done and what would help the tenants in this case is to do what's called a novation. Here you're all agreeing basically to let Javon off the hook. You're moving to the Bahamas. You are no longer responsible under this contract. Rolando is replacing Javon on the contract. That is called a novation. Does Sinya want to do that?
Why not?
Who can she go after now to get her rent payment? Javon, Milton, can she go after? I'm sorry. Milton, Rolando, can she go after Javon? No. So now she has two people she can get money from instead of three. Does that hurt her?
Yes.
Yeah. So normally a landlord's probably not going to want to do this, but this is the cleanest way to make sure that Javon's not still responsible on a contract if he's delegated his responsibilities to Rolando. So I have a quick review for us. I'm going to do this. We're going to do it together in the interest of time. I'm going to quickly pass this out to you. This will kind of give us an idea of all the stuff we've been talking about, a scenario to look at, and it has to do with a lottery winning. We had some good deals today in class. We got some lottery winners here. If you have extras, you can just hold on to them until the end of class here. So this is in the learning module.